You might believe in God as demons believe in God, and demons are no doubt orthodox in their belief in God, and they shudder because their belief is so authentic. And James says, you can have that kind of belief in God, that kind of belief in the gospel, but has absolutely no impact in the quality of life that you live.
James reminds us not to merely listen to the word, but to do what it says. Today's message is called, What to Do with Faith in God.
I'm going to read you this morning from the second half of James chapter 2. We've been looking into this book of James over several weeks so far. I'm going to read from chapter 2 and verse 14 down to verse 26, which is the end of the chapter. James chapter 2. And James asks a very important question at the beginning here. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, What good is that? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I'll show you my faith by what I do. You believe there is one God? Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish man, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend. You see, a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. This is one of the most controversial sections in arguably the most controversial book in the entire Bible. So if you like controversy, I'm glad you're here today. The controversy is this. James asked the question, can faith without deeds save us? And he gives his answer, no, it can't. Verse 17, he adds, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. Verse 24, a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. The reason why this is controversial is because in the 16th century, an event took place in Europe that was like an earthquake in the established church of the day. We call the event, in retrospect, the Reformation. Its decisive cornerstone was a statement that revolutionized Martin Luther, who was the catalyst for this Reformation. The verse that served as that catalyst in his life was in Romans chapter 1 that says, the just shall live by faith, period. That salvation is not by works, but by trust in what Christ has done, irrespective of our works or our behavior. That was the understanding that liberated Martin Luther. And it spread through men, not only like Luther, but Zwingli was a famous preacher in Zurich, John Calvin, a famous preacher in Geneva, and many others as well. And they redefined the essential doctrines of the Christian faith. Not because they were new, they didn't come up with these, but their understanding was they'd gone back to what had been neglected and lost since the New Testament days. And the three essentials that the reformers hit on were salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Luther's life was transformed because he had tried so desperately hard to be justified by what he did. And what he did, he knew in his heart, was never enough. And it never can be. And so he was rejoicing in this freedom and liberty that he had discovered. The just shall live by faith. Righteousness is by faith alone. But then he read the book of James, which says a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. And so Luther called James a highly suspect book, probably should not be in the canon of Scripture, probably not inspired by the Holy Spirit. He called it an epistle of straw, meaning there was no grain, it was just all straw and chaff. And he said, I do not believe it is apostolic. It would be better not to have it in the New Testament. And if you read the Lutheran translation of the Bible in German, it's a key translation in Germany, you'll find it's been relegated to an appendix at the back, not thrown out, but an appendix along with one or two other books that Luther was also uncertain about. Now, if I stood up here this morning and I preached that justification is by works and not by faith, I guarantee some of you would be uncomfortable. A few of you would come to speak to me quietly at the end. Some of you might leave this church and never come back, and I would say, good for you. Because this understanding that our salvation is by faith in Christ alone, by grace alone, is the teaching of the New Testament. But having said that, and other reformers disagree with Luther on this, faith in God must show its validity, not by what you profess, but by the inevitable expression of itself in the life that you live and the works that you do. This is not an addition to faith, faith plus works, but is the inevitable expression of it, and I'll tell you why. I have defined faith from this platform on a number of occasions. I define faith as a disposition of trust in an object that allows the object in which you place your faith to work on your behalf. So if you put faith in a car, you let the car take you down the road. The car does something for you. If you put faith in an aircraft, you fly through the air. The aircraft does something to you. It carries you through the air. You see, faith is more than just believing. Believing can be an intellectual exercise. It's a necessary part of the process. We must believe in order to exercise faith. But faith, by definition, is experiential. If I took you to Pearson Airport here in Toronto and pointed out an airplane to you on the ground and said that plane is going to fly from Toronto to Vancouver, you would believe it because planes fly every day from Toronto to Vancouver, nothing unusual about that. You would believe it, we all believe it. But if you put your faith in that aircraft, that is a very different exercise. To put your faith in the fact this aircraft is flying to Vancouver means you get on the plane and you fly to Vancouver. The evidence of your faith is in the fact something happens. You fly from Toronto to Vancouver. Now here James is saying that you cannot give evidence of your faith apart from resulting action that comes from your dependency upon Jesus Christ. So I will show you my faith, he says, by what I do. I will show you I have faith in the aircraft by what I do. What am I doing? I'm flying to Vancouver. Something's happening. You might believe the plane flies. You might be nervous about flying, you might not trust it, but that's okay, you're free to do that, but you'll never leave Toronto. It's not a problem with your belief, it's a problem with your exercising faith in what you believe that the plane is flying to Toronto. Now, there's an awful possibility of believing the gospel without placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And thus enabling Christ to do in us what he himself does and simply expresses himself in us and through us. And this awful possibility is spoken about by James when he says in verse 18, someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds. I'll show you my faith by what I do. And then he says, you believe there is one God? Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. And James says, you can have that kind of belief in God, that kind of belief in the gospel, where you say, yes, it's true. I grew up hearing it was true, or I came to a point of learning it was true. I believe it, but it has absolutely no impact in the quality of life that you live. That is the awful possibility he's speaking about here. You can have belief without deeds, but you cannot have faith without deeds. When your belief becomes faith and you put your faith in Jesus Christ. If the evidence of faith in a plane is that you fly, in other words, you do what the plane does, you fly. The evidence of faith in God is that you do what God does. Not in his omnipotence, of course, but what he wants to do here on earth, we become united with his purpose. And so there are three evidences that James gives that we are genuinely living by faith, and these evidences are demonstrated in what we do. The first one is that faith is evidenced in compassion. In verse 15 and 16, he says that. He says, suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is that? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. Now, we split up the book of James for ease of studying it, but you will notice that these themes have already been creeping into James's earlier writing. In chapter 1 and verse 27, he says, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is to be in the church every morning on a Sunday and preferably in a life group as well. Is that what he says? No. What God accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress. In other words, they are left bereft. They're in distress. And to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. This, he says, is what God is looking for. He's not looking for meticulous, detailed Bible study. That's important. Of course it is. But that isn't what he's looking for, is the evidence of your faith. Is that you actually care about people who are in need. In chapter 2 and verse 8 and 9, he says, if you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, and we looked at this last week, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin. And the whole theme in the first half of the chapter we looked at last time was this whole issue of favoritism, this whole issue of prejudice. No, he says, you love your neighbor without favoritism. This is the royal law. Because when you're living in this relationship with God, then what people see in you, what people are to see in me, will be in some way an expression of what God is like. His character is imparted to us. Now, if you put faith in something passive, you will experience it passively. So if I put faith in a chair and I sit on the chair will hold me in place. It's a passive act and it's good and it's necessary. But that's the evidence of my faith on the chair. I'm sitting in that position. I put faith in this microphone and I talk normally and my voice is amplified sufficiently for all of you to hear what I'm saying. That is faith in something passive. But if you put faith in something active, you join in the activity of the object of your faith. So if you put faith in an elevator, you will rise up to the next floor. If you put faith in a train, you will travel down the railroad track. you have faith in an aircraft, you will fly through the air. Because if you put faith in something that is active, you'll become united to its activity, and what it does, you do. And true faith in God unites us to the activity of God. God is not passive. It's not look back, what did he do? That I believe what he did. That's it, passively. It's what is he doing? The living Christ at work in our world. John, a couple of pages later, says that this is actually evidence that we are truly born again. So this is not just James saying this. John, in different words, says it. He says in 1 John 3:14, we know that we pass from death to life because we love our brothers. Anyone who does not love remains in death. How do you know you're a Christian? Well, here's the evidence, you love. Really? Yes. You love your brothers, he says. If you don't love, you're appetizing that you've remained in death. 1 John 4:8, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he's a liar. He says, because God is love, you are not merely imitating him, you're living in dependence on him, which is what it is to put your faith in him, so that his character begins to be shown in our characters. He's being himself in us. And compassion is the natural first expression of the Christian life. But the problem is, we can be moved with compassion, and then you go and lie down and get over it. You feel a bit better afterwards. No, move with compassion, which is the beginning of the heart of God, has to work its way out in natural compassion. We have some great examples of that here this morning. We have Stuart here with us this morning, working amongst kids living on the tracks of a railway station, uncared for by anybody else, coming in and feeding and nurturing and getting to know them and loving them, and in as much as the numbers allow, moving some of them into a home that we help to build where they can receive education and 3 meals a day and love and kindness. 22 children are living in that environment. Jean Chamberlain Froese is here this morning as well. Medical doctor who's given her life to saving mothers who unnecessarily die in the process of childbirth, which is not infrequent in certain parts of the world. And investing life and energy in this kind of ministry, and this is the greater demonstration of the heart of God. All these things are. And we can never show just by being here on a Sunday morning. This is where it fleshes out. God, what is your heart? Plant your heart in me. It's compassion. That'll express itself in a multitude of different ways. But compassion. And James is saying, an example is, if you say to a man who's poor, sick, weak, go, I wish you well, I really do, keep warm and fed. And here's the worst thing, I'll pray for you. You know, praying can be the biggest cop-out. Because we can go to prayer groups and prayer meetings and we pray without reserve and we pray for all kinds of things but never participate. And prayer without action is dead, as well as faith without action is dead. So faith is seen in compassion is the first thing. Secondly, faith is seen in compliance. I'll explain what I mean by that, because in verse 21 to 24, he talks about Abraham, uses this illustration. By compliance, I mean obedience and cooperation with him, compliance with God. He says in verse 23, Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. And he was called God's friend. You see that a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. Now, James refers to two crucial events in Abraham's life. The first was when God made a covenant with Abraham, took him outside into the sky one night. Look up into the sky. How many stars can you see? Many. Well, let me tell you something, Abraham. You are going to have as many descendants as the stars in the sky. Your wife is going to give birth to a son, and from that son will come a nation. That nation will bless the world. And that was an almost impossible suggestion because Abraham was 75 and Sarah was 65, been married for donkey's years. They had no children. They'd never conceived. She's past the menopause anyway. And here's God saying, you're going to have as many descendants as the stars in the sky. I'll give you a son. From that son will come a nation. And Abraham, it says, believed God. And it was credited to him as righteousness. What did Abraham do? He basically said this, God, that is impossible to me and impossible certainly to my wife, because your word says she's barren. But thank you. I trust you. Went home and told his wife. And she laughed, but she also began to believe. The point is, you've made a promise. I can't do anything about that. That's yours to fulfill. I trust you. And on those grounds, Abraham, it says in Romans 4, if Abraham was justified by works, he had nothing to boast about. He was justified entirely by saying, God, you said it, you do it. I trust you. But the second event that James refers to was not a passive trust in what God had promised. Because God told Abraham then to offer his son Isaac, once he'd been born, and it took many years before he was born, to offer him in sacrifice. Now Abraham has to do something. He has to obey. Verse 21, was not our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? His first act of faith was passive. God promised, I trust God to do it. This second act of faith is active. He has to actually do something. And what he had to do was horrific in the sense that every promise God had made to Abraham was wrapped up in his son Isaac, dependent on the life and health of his son Isaac. From your son will come a nation. It'll be as numerous as the stars in the sky. Now says God, take your son and offer him as a sacrifice on Mount Moriah. What's Abraham going to do? They say, well, Lord, if you want to do that, you do it. You know, I'll wake up in the morning, he'll be dead in his bed, and that's your doing. No, he has to do something. He has to do something courageous, has to do something costly, has to do something very hard. He takes his son. Genesis says, early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey and took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. He got up early the next morning. I remember once speaking about that and saying this is because Abraham was eager to obey. And afterwards, Hillary said to me, no, I think it was so that Sarah wouldn't know. I said, you mean Sarah would still be in bed? But yeah, you don't go and say, well, Sarah, Isaac and I are going off tomorrow. Say goodbye. He won't come back. I'm going to offer him as a sacrifice. I'm not sure Sarah would be very compliant. But Abraham now knows this. I've trusted God and he's given me the son. Along with that trust in God must be obedience to God. He took him up Mount Moriah. He built an altar. Isaac, his son, helping him build the altar. He arranged the wood on the altar. Isaac asked the obvious question. We've got the wood, we've got the altar, we don't have the lamb. Abraham said, God will provide the lamb. And he took his son Isaac and he bound him, laid him on the altar with his knife in the air, ready to plunge it into Isaac's body. God said, Abraham, don't hurt the boy. Now I know you fear God. Now I know you mean business. And there was a ram caught in a thicket nearby. And they took the ram God had provided, the lamb. Abraham had trusted God passively. That's the beginning of it all. Now God is testing Abraham actively. That is going to come in our lives. There's a passive element. We recognize Christ died for our sins. There's nothing to do except say, thank you. Jesus said, it is done, it is finished. We say, thank you. But now the Christian life, to be shown to be genuine, moves from the passive faith to the active obedience. He says in verse 22, you see it, Abraham's faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. Okay, you say you believe in God. Now that faith is made complete by what you do. As a result of that, the writer of the Hebrews sums this up when he says of Abraham in Hebrews 11, verse 17, by faith Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promise, passive, was about to sacrifice his one and only son, active, even though God had said to him, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. And Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead if necessary, and figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac back from the dead. Abraham knew this. I obey God in the most illogical way that goes right against everything God has promised. If he has to raise Isaac from the dead, that's his business. All I know I have to do is to obey him, get my hands dirty, get my heart broken, get identified with the activity of God. You'll know it was a beautiful foreshadowing too, of course, of Christ. That's another subject. The point is with Abraham, that because he obeyed, he is called God's friend in verse 23. God's friends are those who trust him. God's friends are those who obey him. God's friends are those who are compliant with him. And compliant means that the will of God becomes the will of Abraham. And this is our privilege too, to be his friends. But there's a third area. His faith was evidenced in compassion. Faith is evidenced in compliance. But thirdly, faith is evidenced in courage in verse 25. Because he says this, in the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? This is an intriguing story. Comes from the book of Joshua. When they're about to take the land of Canaan, Joshua sent two spies into Jericho, the first city they had to conquer. And they came to this house of Rahab. Very bluntly, James says, Rahab the prostitute. Some think the word for prostitute should have been translated innkeeper. It's a little more easy on the palate. But no. He is amplifying here that our spiritual pedigree or our inbuilt good behavior are totally irrelevant to real faith. We fall back on those as kind of backup securities. But they're irrelevant. So they came, entered the house of a prostitute named Rahab. She was on the city wall. She evidently ran a brothel there. No doubt the two spies wanted to be anonymous, and where can you be more anonymous than in visiting the house of a prostitute, because men were doing that all the time, anonymously. It's not unusual to see unknown people creeping in there. So that's probably why they chose this as a place to hide themselves. They said, could we stay here? And she gave them a place to stay. And they took her into their confidence and said, we are from the Israelites. We've been out in the desert for 40 years. And they said, we're going to come and take this city. And they came to an agreement with her if she would hide them in her house on the city wall. When they came to conquer the city, they would preserve her house, her family, as long as she let out a red cord so that the soldiers of Israel would recognize that is the house we'd leave alone. They agreed to that. And before the spies went to sleep that night, Rahab came up to speak to them. And I'm going to quote you from Joshua chapter 2 and verse 9. She said, I know that the Lord has given this land to you, and that a great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the waters of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. That was 40 years before. We heard that for 40 years. And what you did to Sihon and Og, the two kings of the Amorites east of the Jordan, whom you completely destroyed, that was just a few weeks before. So she's saying, for 40 years, we have been waiting for the news that a nomadic group of people were coming across the desert, and when they come across the desert, and when they arrive at our city, verse 11, when we heard of it, our hearts melted, everyone's courage failed because of you, for the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below. She says, we've known that when you folks arrive here, our days are numbered, because not because of you, but because of your God. Your God is the God of heaven above and of the earth below. It's interesting to notice the difference in faith Rahab had and the spies had. She said, I know God has given you this land. In the past tense, it's yours. The spies responded, if you don't tell what we're doing, we'll treat you kindly and faithfully when the Lord gives us a land. That's an uncertain future tense. When, not quite if. She had more faith in God than the spies of Israel did. And notice something else in Rahab's statement. The Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below. Do you know why the Israelites have been struggling so much in the wilderness for 40 years? Because they had a God in the heaven above, but they did not have a God on the earth below. God, we worship you, we praise you, you're great, you're exalted, so what? He's not just a God in heaven, as Rahab says, but a God on the earth below. And that is where he does his business. That is where he is doing his work. God is God in heaven above. You won't expect much of him, nor will you cooperate very much, nor will you be in compliance with him. But you'll worship him, and no doubt you'll study the word to know a bit about him, and you have it all worked out. He's omnipotent, he's omnipresent, he's omniscient, he's eternal, he's big, he's almighty, he's sovereign. So what if you don't let him in on the earth below? And that's why Rahab is taken by James out of the Old Testament and stuck, I suggest, into his book as a prime example, because here's a woman who had very little theology, but she knew enough to know if God is God on heaven above and on earth below, then I'm going to take the courage to work with him. So she said to the men, you go and hide. And then some folks came to the door, some soldiers, and said, we understand you've got two spies here. No, he said, they came, but they've gone again. I mean, it's a big, red, hairy lie, you know? But she tells it to them. And then she goes back up to the men and says, look, the soldiers have been out, sent them off in the wrong direction. Now you go out to the hills and you hide there for 3 days, and they'll give up the hunt after that, and then you come back, and then you can take this city. But preserve me and my family. We're going to hang the red cord outside of the window. And this is Rahab the prostitute. Ever judge a book by its cover? Never judge somebody by how they appear. In fact, if you find yourself very concerned with how you appear, what you are portraying may not be what's underneath. You're disguising it. This is Rahab the prostitute. There's no evidence she stopped doing that business, actually. You know, Jesus said to the priests and elders in the temple courts in Jerusalem, in Matthew 21, he said to them, these are the men connected with the religious mainstream of Israel, totally committed to the books of Moses and the law of Moses. I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. I would suggest one good reason. They don't have great difficulty in being honest. They know they're so messed up. The rest of us, who are equally messed up in our own ways, have great difficulty being honest about it. And so we actually are not the first to enter. We're last. And the danger is we're not at all. Abraham was the friend of God, James says. Rahab was the prostitute. But the demonstration of their faith is that in their dependence upon God, God worked in them. The only explanation for their lives is in trust in God. The activity of God was worked out through them. They said, you put trust in the elevator, you'll rise to the next floor. That's what faith does. And something active, you share the activity. You're caught up in the activity. When a man or woman, boy or girl, is caught up in the activity of God, because our faith, not just our belief, but our actual faith, our trust, our obedience, which takes courage, as it did for Rahab, takes compassion because God is love. It takes compliance. We obey what he says. Then it leads to a life that demonstrates Jesus Christ is in you. We oughtn't to need to tell people we're Christians. We oughtn't to need to tell people. They should see. Because the quality of life that we live. Let me finish with this. When I used to work with young people, which I did for many years, I'd often explain to them what I called the ABC of salvation. A means you need to admit your need, admit your sin, admit your inadequacy, admit your weakness, and that you never move beyond admitting your need. It's the first step. B, you need to believe. I'd say to them that Jesus Christ took your sin on himself. He died as your substitute, was buried, and was raised again, and will indwell you by his Spirit. You need to believe that. But that won't save you. There's a C. It is to commit. That is, on the basis of what you believe, you step into everything God is and does and wants, and you obey him. I often use an illustration like this. There's a train going from Toronto to Montreal. You might hear the train's going at 10 o'clock in the morning. You purchase a ticket, you go down to the station, Union Station, you turn up at 9:45. You see the sign which tells you platform 3 is the platform the train will leave from. And at 5 to 10, you find yourself on the platform and you stand there and you say, I believe that train is going to Montreal. And while you stand there saying, I believe that train is going to Montreal, it pulls out of the station, goes down the line, and might as well be going to Timbuktu as far as you're concerned, because it's not enough to believe. It's not enough to believe. You've got to get on the train. You've got to align our lives with our hearts, with the heart of Jesus Christ, our lives with the life of Jesus Christ, and what he is doing in our world. We are not observers of it. We're in the thick of it. Faith without works is dead. Not because faith is inadequate, but because the faith is not true faith. It's only belief. Until you find that the Spirit of God in you is moving us to will and to act according to the pleasure of Jesus Christ. We'll be compassionate. We'll be compliant with His will and direction. And we'll be courageous. And we'll do things we would never have thought we would do in obedience to Him. And we'll see God work. So we enter into real union with Christ. His compassion is our compassion. His will is our will. And I'll show you my faith, says James, by what I do.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Next week, a special Mother's Day message from Hillary Price on Living Truth.
God, in my frustration, in my failure, I'm just asking you to come into this situation. So in times of pressure, go to God in prayer. In times of pleasure, go to God in praise.
The book of James reminds us not to merely listen to the word, but to do what it says. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca.
So, do you know what James really says about all of this? He says, just do it. Just do it.
The School of Nursing at Herbert Perk Christian Hospital has two purposes. Firstly, it trains nurses to work in the EHA network of hospitals and clinics across northern India. And secondly, it gives young women a way out of poverty by giving them an opportunity for education. This training breaks the cycle of poverty and gives them the chance to earn a living. There are many girls in towns like this one who want and need this opportunity. One of them is Guti.
Guti is 16. She lives at the Carver Children's Home. It's a hostel for girls who are orphans or whose parents cannot afford to keep them.
I am from a very poor family. My father has leprosy. My mom is always sick. We never had enough money for their treatments.
Guti is one of three daughters. That's an economic and social problem for an Indian family, where sons are prized and daughters are seen as liabilities.
I am from another background. We used to worship all kinds of different gods. We had a lot of problems. We never had enough food. Sometimes we didn't have enough to eat from one meal to the next. We could never study properly because my father couldn't pay for the school fees. My parents would never have enough money for their treatments either. So everyone would say that God would open a door.
A door opened when Guti came to the hostel. Here she learned about Christ. She went back to school, and she made a best friend, Suman.
Since I came to the hostel, my mother got well. And slowly things started to get better in my family. Since I came here, my life has changed a lot. Before I knew the Lord, nothing was right with my family.
When Suman reached the age of 19, she was selected to train at the Herbert Poor School of Nursing. It meant Guti's best friend moved away to live at the hospital.
I miss my best friend. I was really hurt and sad when I left that I was leaving her. Because I was very close to her, we shared many stories with each other. And the more we talked, the closer we got. She is like a sister to me. She's more than a sister to me. I just miss her a lot. I was sad when she told me she would be going to the other home. She would be leaving me. But I was happy for her at the same time, because she has a chance to study nursing. I dream that I too will be able to study nursing someday. I hope I can do nursing like her.
Both of these girls came to the hostel through difficult circumstances, but good can come out of their troubles.
I got accepted for training through the hostel. Maybe if I hadn't been at this hostel, I wouldn't be able to go for my training either.
Dr. Daniel Rajkumar is the medical director of the nursing school at Herbert Poor Hospital, where Suman is a trainee.
We also chose students from disadvantaged backgrounds, as in family circumstances. Maybe they were had problems where they could not get the best of education, or family situation where their family life was disrupted, or various situations like that where their opportunities for the future were very limited. So we also had space given to them when we admitted our students.
Guti now has a dream. She wants to be a nurse like Suman. She knows it won't be easy.
It is hard. Suman did tell me it was very hard. But if I work hard, then perhaps I can do well, and I'll be able to stand on my own feet.
And we choose students who have the aptitude for service in a community. We chose students who would not only look at it as a purely as a profession where they would be going and earning money, but they would be looking at it as trying to give back something through their training to the community wherever they would be serving.
I want to be a nurse because through nursing, I can help others. It's written in the Bible how to love one another and take care of others. So through nursing, if I'm able to stand on my own feet, then I can help others. And since my family is poor, I can help support my family too. And I can help them to believe in God.
Access to Christian nursing training will give Guti and Suman a career, dignity, and purpose.
King of my life, I crown you now. Thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget your thorn crown brow. Lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where you were laid, tenderly mourned and wept. Angels in robes of light array guarded you while you slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me, like Mary, through the gift for thee. Well, show to me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary. And may I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee. Even your cup of grief to share, for you have borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Jesus, lead me. Oh, lead me to Calvary. To Calvary.